I mean, I just like 2 days ago, I saw a video of this like little baby and a grandpa, and I lost it and cried for probably like an hour.
Yeah, because then you start thinking about those things like, oh, he's never going to get to see this. He's never going to get to see that. He didn't get to see me graduate from high school. He didn't get to see me graduate from college. Yeah, things like that. I never get to introduce him to a significant other. Yeah. And yeah, all those things just start racing in your brain. And it's like, you know what? It's going to happen. Just let it happen. Just let it all out. If you can call someone to talk it over, talk it over. Relatable.
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 Are you wearing
your
shirt?
Why is it drooping?
Because it just wants to.
What shirt? Oh, no. I was going to put it on and I forgot. I have it sitting in here. I'm not wearing. Are you wearing yours? Okay, wait. Pause it. Queen above 18. Here in sunny Palm Springs.
Yeah, hey, welcome back.
This is Relatable, episode 19. As you can see, I'm in Palm Springs.
Yeah, I said that.
Dylan
already.
Is in a red room.
I'm in a red room.
And today's episode is taking a little bit of a different kind of turn today.
That's right. For any of you that have ever heard of the podcast The Honeydew, which is a fantastic one, hosted by Ryan Sickler in Night Pants Studio. If you haven't heard of it, go give that a listen. But basically, we're going to have our own Honeydew episode today.
Wait, so what do you mean?
I've sent you videos of his, and we've talked about this. So it's basically on his podcast, what he says is, he likes to highlight the lowlights of people's lives because it's not always glitz and glam.
It's not. That's true.
And so what he does is, yeah, he gets people on and he talks about with them just, you know, the really shitty things that have happened in their lives and how they've been able to move past it and all of that. Because the reason why I really liked his stuff and why I connected was because he has a very similar story to ours, sort of. But not exactly. His was way worse, in my opinion. But yeah, like, you know, that's what we're going for today.
That is what we're going
for. We're highlighting the lowlights. So yeah, we're not talking about an easy subject today. And the reason for that is because we're getting close to August. And August is our father's birthday on August 25th.
Yeah, and so he would have been 62.
What?
He would have been 62.
Ooh, I didn't realize he was
that
much older.
It's so weird. I don't know. Well, it's been a long time. It's been, so our dad died in 2007.
Yeah, 2007.
In a car accident. And
62. That's
he would have been 62. He was 47 years old. Jeez. Which is a trip because, like,
that's only like 17 years away for me.
Yeah, it's not very far.
Oh, and that was almost how old I was. Oh,
it's weird. And you were 16.
Yeah, I just turned 16. 19. So yeah. He passed away on the 22nd of December.
Mm-hmm.
So it was also right before Christmas. A great time of year, as everyone knows.
Yeah, great time
for people
to
pass away.
Exit.
He chose a hell of a day, let me tell you.
Yeah.
and yeah, so it was a. Do you want to go over your experience of it first, or?
Well, I thought a good thing to do to just start it off is to first just give a glimpse of like his personality. So I have a video clip that I was going to share really quick. So this will at least give you, like, let's give you some context. So
of a video of a video.
It's sad. It's a video of a video because I'm an old camcorder, but I haven't been able to figure out how to upload it. Otherwise, I think this is from 2002.
Sarah Stone's first day in the snow.
You can tell he doesn't get out much. Not even on. No, yeah, the record button's on.
I still have that jacket, by the way. That's hanging in my closet. His dad's like military jacket.
Yeah. There he is. Literally, it's like all of us pushing each other. We're over at Idlewild.
Pick your feet up. Pick your feet up.
There goes Dylan. Is it choppy for you? I tried to optimize it, but
I mean, it's a little bit, but that could also just be the like three layers of filming.
Hey, that was a good yeah. ride. Even further than Angela.
There he is, always pushing everyone down. I think I have. Oh yeah, here's us playing ball. And he had back surgeries and stuff, so he's actually moving around pretty good here.
Yeah, I was going to say, he still doesn't look that bad. That must have been before he really started putting on the weight after the surgery.
Yeah. So I had that one, and then I was going to, and then I had, hold on. I just had a couple little things I was going to share.
I can't believe you don't have the Captain Crunch one.
I didn't have time to...
Captain to pull Crunch. It up.
I know, what a goober. Yeah, I didn't have time to find all of them, but
yeah, so to give you some background information on our father, he was born in the Coachella Valley.
Mm-hmm.
In 1960, right?
Yeah,
in 1960.
Smallest of four. Youngest of four. He was the baby. Youngest of
four. One older brother, two older sisters.
And he was the little life of the party.
Oh, yeah.
All right, here's...
Your lands to me, Dad, to them. Oh, come on.
Always giving Mom a hard time.
He was a beautifully handsome Mexican man with a great mustache, which I think is why, also the fact that I'm bald, but like I feel like I need to have a nice mustache. But I didn't get his coloring. I got Mom's, which is sucks because I burn.
Oh yeah.
I didn't get that beautiful. I didn't get that nice dark skin or. Just the nice tanning that he would get. Because whenever we'd go out and work in the backyard, like he'd get like nice and dark, and then I'd just be a freaking cherry tomato. Fucking worst.
I was trying to see. Okay, maybe this one won't be. This is a good one.
So if you couldn't tell, Angela really enjoyed filming things. As a child?
Oh, that was my, like, when I graduated middle school, I got a camcorder.
He used to tell people he was Italian.
It's mistletoe. Give me a kiss.
Was that?
Yeah.
Who was that? That was that said they made that. That was
Alexis. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So I want to figure out a way to show you these without it being so choppy. I think it's because of the size of the videos, but yeah. So he was always the life of the party. But yeah, I guess today we're talking about I guess. I don't know.
More background stuff. Like, he was always a very handy person. He was always very good at.
Yes.
He was good and he was stubborn at fixing things.
Yes.
Because he was one of those guys that was like, no, we don't need to pay someone. I can figure this out. So like he always was fixing our AC unit.
Cars. Here's a perfect. I was going to show you this really quick because this is exactly him crawling in the attic trying to fix something.
Oh my God. Yeah.
He's got scrub pants on. He's got a ninja hat on. He's got scrubs. Yeah.
Well, because it's all exposed. Goggles. It was all exposed up there. And all the insulation was exposed up in the attic. Probably not a good thing. It got really hot. And for those of you that don't know about insulation, it's got those tiny bits of fiberglass in it that like they cut you and they become really, really itchy when they make contact with your skin. Cause I had to go up there a couple times too. And he would dress me up like that. Oh, so bad.
They don't make men like that anymore. I tell you what.
Yeah, no, he was always very handy. He was also because he was so handy, he knew how to jerry-rig things. Like, I remember not too long after he passed, when mom finally had to call AC repair guy, he came out and he's like, oh, you know what? I found something really odd with your guys' AC unit. Because I assume they still have it, but basically the power company will give you credit credit on your billing for them to be able to cycle your AC, so they can basically just like turn it off for like an hour whenever they want, like once a day or something like that, and then it's supposed to save because you're saving electricity, blah blah blah, bunch of nonsense. So because dad was so handy, they got that, and then he found his way to jerry rig and bypass that, so it would read.
Oh, I didn't know that.
It would read that it was cycling the AC, but the AC stayed on the whole time. And when mom found that out, she was like, shit, they took out dad's thing.
We're fucked.
I was like, that sucks. Or like, yeah, whenever he would jerry-rig the cable and all of that to split into all the different multiple rooms.
Splitting cable.
When we only actually paid for one cable box, he was like, don't worry, I got away. I know a guy, he'd call his friends like Tom or Bill, and he'd be like, yeah, come over here. We're gonna figure this out.
Yeah, I think that we only pay for one thing of cable, and then everything else in the house was maybe two, and everything else in the house is split.
Yeah, mom and dad's their bathroom.
They didn't have cable in their bathroom.
No, I mean the shower remodel.
You're just talking about remodeling.
Mom's walk-in closet. I always remember because his friend Tom helped him on that one, and dad always liked to have a tidy workspace. So as Tom's sitting there banging shit, breaking the wall down, dad's behind him sweeping, and he's like, Lance, what the fuck are you doing? He's like, I'm just gonna keep doing this, wait until I'm all done. He's like, no, we gotta have a clean, just like you do your thing, I'll do my thing.
Jeez. Yeah. I don't know how about that.
He liked a 4x4. That was another thing, because was it an 88 Bronco or an 86?
I have no clue.
I think it was an 88. We'll say it was, because that was the year you were born. Yeah, an 88 Bronco. Sure. we'd go 4x4 and we'd get stuck all the time in.
Well, that's because he let you drive it.
He let you drive it too.
I didn't get it stuck though. You did.
Well, that's because someone told me to hit the brakes. So I was like, oh, okay, I'll hit the brake. And I slammed that brake.
And we had to walk home.
We did have to walk.
In the heat.
Yeah, in the middle of the desert. So yeah, fun time.
Yeah, so we had a pretty hands-on dad.
We were pretty lucky
in that respect. So.
So yeah, so when he, what was that? Was that in 2000? We little Lulu over here, pretend like she's howling at the moon.
That did look like she was howling at the moon.
Was it in 2000 that dad broke his back?
He didn't break his back when he got a back injury.
He herniated.
I don't know what year it was.
I want to say I was in like the first or second grade.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he herniated a disc in his back. He had to have surgery. And he got two metal plates put in, one in the front, one in the back. And that really goofed up things that were going on for him. Because yeah, he worked at a grocery store as an assistant manager. And then he worked for our grandpa at an ice company that was family owned. Then, what was it like? I don't remember how much longer afterwards, but he ended up getting workman's comp and mm-hmm. they paid for him to basically do some sort of schooling for him to not really have
to. Well, he went back to work for a while.
For a little while, yeah.
And then he had a second surgery and then through workman's comp and stuff.
Then that's when that happened.
Yeah, and then he went to school and became a pharmacy technician and then... Mm-hmm. He worked at a pharmacy for a while until his accident.
Yep. But yeah, so that was our dad. So do you want to go over your experience of the whole situation and then I'll go over mine or.
Sure. Well,
let's go through the setup. So yeah, it's December 22nd. For me personally, what was that? Was that a Friday?
I don't know.
All I recall is that I had basically just gotten released from school for like the Christmas break. And my mom and I were watching the Pirates of the Caribbean's third movie. and my dad came home from work, you know, said hi, all that. And then he was like, I'm going to go to my friend Tom's house because we're working on something over there. And we're like, oh, okay. And then he took off and that was the last time I saw him. And so, yeah, like, you know, just normal day. Me and Ma finished watching that movie. I don't remember what else I ended up doing. And then I went to sleep that night. And then I got woken up in like the middle of the night / morning. By my aunt who was over and I was like, what in the world is happening right now?
What are you doing here?
So yeah, what were you doing on the 22nd?
My boyfriend and I were getting ready to go to Minerva Street in Palm Springs, which is a street that puts up a bunch of Christmas lights. And we actually that night, probably about the time that it happened, had pulled up to a street. So the intersection that he was at was maybe a mile down, if not a little more. So we pulled up to a street that actually hits one of the roads that he crossed when he got in his accident, but about a mile this way. And I was in the left turn lane to turn towards basically where that would have taken place. And while I was sitting there in the turn lane, which was weird, there were no cars out there at all. And so usually if you're the only one at an intersection, the turn signal is going to turn on first. Well, the turn signal didn't turn on. It stayed red. And instead the signal to go straight turned green. So I was like, okay, well, I'll just go this way to get there. So instead of turning left where I would have been there either right before or right after, whatever happened, I pulled out of the turn lane and I went straight. And that night we also watched with my ex-boyfriend and his mom watched what is the movie with Adam Sandler?
There's a lot of
them. the really sad one about
Click?
The guy that lost his family. No,
that
he lost his family in 9/11.
You're right. Click didn't come out yet.
No.
Because I remember crying in the movie theater when Click came out.
Click is not a sad movie.
Click is a sad as fuck movie. Are you kidding me? It's only because at the end he has that like super heartfelt dad moment. And that's why I cried. So yeah, because of this, things with like fathers and all that usually make me like start tearing up and I get super emotional and I'm like, God damn.
Oh yeah. Whoa, yeah.
That shit hits home. Yeah, because I feel like, hold on. Now I got to Google when Click came out. That was a super sad movie.
We didn't watch Click. We watched Rain Over Me. Do you remember that movie, though?
I do not remember Rain Over Me.
It's with...
Oh, never mind. Click came out before Dad passed. Whoops. See,
well, maybe you watched it after, though.
It could have been Click. You could have watched that.
It could have been Click. We watched it. It was Rain Over Me with Don Cheadle, Adam Sandler, and it's about this guy that loses his family in 9/11. It's really, really sad and depressing. Oh, and God. I remember watching it and saying out loud, man, I'm really glad that like so lucky and so blessed to have my family. Hashtag literally blessed. That night.
Way to go.
So I was woken up in the middle of the night by a phone call from my mom. And at that time, I was staying with my boyfriend. I kind of like lived at home and lived there. And I usually like wouldn't answer a phone call from her like in the middle of the night. But
yeah,
I was like, I don't know. I probably would have thought I was going to get in trouble or something. It wasn't my best time of my life. I was 19 and I was out drinking and partying and stuff. And so I answered the phone and she was like, can Tom drive you to the house? And I was like, why? And she's like, I need you to come home. And I was like, why? And she's like, I just need you to come home. And I asked her, because I knew I could tell something was wrong. And I said, is Dad okay? And she wouldn't answer that. She just said, I just need you to come home. And so when I got home, well, I don't know. What happened after Aunt Lisa woke you up?
So Aunt Lisa woke me up. And yeah, she was a bit choked up. And yeah, I was just like, what is going on right now? And she's just like, fuck. It's funny because people are usually like, when you're in situations like that, you remember everything. I don't. Like, I purposefully tried to like block all of that out / put myself in denial even to this day. Because yeah, I don't remember if she told me or if she had just asked me to come into the living room, but I just remember there was a police officer there. Mom was crying on the couch.
And yeah, and you see that and you're like, this isn't good.
I was like, oh fuck, what did Mom do now? And then there were like two Ziploc baggies on the coffee table. Yeah, because one had Dad's keys and his wallet in it. That's like the only thing I do remember. And then I don't remember what the other one had in it. But I saw that and that made me just like fucking snap. And I was just like, oh, fuck.
Well, you know, at that point, what's coming, like, you just know, like, you yeah. still have to hear it, but you know.
And yeah, I don't think you were home yet. I think you came like maybe 20 minutes after that.
Yeah.
yeah, you fucking came in.
You just yeah, and then I come in.
Cry.
You're on the couch crying. Lisa's on the couch crying. Mom's on the couch crying. And there's a police officer, and no one's like... looking at me. No one's looking at me. No one's making eye contact with me. And I'm like,
no, I gotta say, that's gotta be a shit job. I'm sorry for that police officer to have to like
tell everyone, like, Mom made him stay. You are gonna tell every person in this household before you go in anywhere.
Like, fucking awkward. Fucking awkward. Yeah.
Well, I just remember him then telling me, like, well, your dad was involved in an accident. He was driving down Dinah Shore and he went across an intersection and he hit another driver and the cars flipped. And I'm like, and is he alive? Like, and like, spare me the fucking details. Like, yeah. So what's is he alive? And then, yeah. And then he said that he didn't make it. And I think that's when I went numb. and it's almost like your hearing goes out for a minute.
You get that, like,
and you're not hungry, you're not thirsty, you don't feel anything. Yeah.
Yeah, you're just like, yeah, you're just in shock, pretty much.
Yeah. It was like an outer body experience, I think, the most.
And then
it was weird.
And like, I don't even remember when I then tried to go to sleep again. Cause like, I remembered all of us just being in the living room for a long time. And that's honestly it.
Well, cause like, you feel like you can't do anything else. Like, what else are you gonna do?
And then, yeah, like after that, like the next 2 days, the family was just over, like cooking for us. And just, it was like we had an open house or something, or like a family reunion.
Yeah.
Because like everybody came over, everybody was there. Even like friends of mine came over. And
yeah,
one of them in particular I remember was Rafer. Cause
yeah,
like I had stopped all of my, like I feel like I had gotten most of all my crying out. And I was like, you know, like this is apparently just how it's going to be. And Rafer came into my room crying. And he's like, I'm so sorry. And I'm like, God damn it, Rafer. I just finished all of this. And now you're going to make me cry again. You son of a bitch.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was... Ooh. Go for it.
I remember the next day we had plans to go see fucking Sweeney Todd.
Because
that was out. And I still went to the movies the next day to see Sweeney Todd. And it was me and Tom and Aurora, I think, went with me. And I think Selena went too.
Yeah.
We all went and watched Sweeney Todd. And I think about this now too, because the whole time I'm like trying to watch a movie, but I'm like disassociating. And then now I'm thinking too, like, how awkward for my friends to be there and be like, whatever you want to do, we'll do it. Like, cause we care about you. And they're just probably like also the whole time, like they're not able to watch the movie. They're like, fuck, I can't even really enjoy this. Cause my friend's over here and her dad just died. Like what? Like,
I mean, hey, but people go through it different and they experience it different. And
yeah,
like, I'm pretty sure like mom was with all the family. Yeah. I'm probably just stayed in my room and tried to play video games to like just keep myself out of it.
Yeah.
Cause I'd finally gotten a sweet TV. It was like this big. It was up in the corner of my room. We played 4-player Halo on it. Mm-hmm. I don't even know how. Like the TV that I play on now is so much bigger, and you split
when
that
when we were
in
kids
half.
We had to work for everything.
You split that TV in half for a split screen and I can't see shit. I'm like, I don't know how I did it. It's the power of youth,
man. Well, yeah, that's
it was just a
weird time.
It was all around crappy experience.
Well, and then so to talk about 2007 and tie this in, I was like, well, what kind of stuff happened in 2007, right? Mm-hmm. Like, what was happening in our world when all this went down? Well, 2007, I believe, is when they released the first iPhone. Did you know that?
I didn't know that because I don't think I saw an iPhone until maybe the next year.
He didn't have an iPhone. I think it was when they first released it.
Because I think it was that next year that I finally had a friend who was like, oh yeah, dude, check out my iPhone. And I was like, what the fuck is this?
Britney Spears had her meltdown that year.
Oh, that was Leave Britney Alone year, huh?
And Keeping Up with the Kardashians debuted that year. God, that's the important
terrible
stuff.
Attachment. That's why. Thanks a lot, Dad. You're the reason why Angela watches Keeping Up with the Kardashians.
The hotties and fashion icons were Lindsay Lohan, Jessica Alba, Eva Longoria, Victoria Beckham, Rihanna, Eva Mendes, Scarlett Johansson, Jessica Biel, Gwen Stefani, Christina Aguilera, Ali Carter, Fergie, and Megan Fox.
You didn't name any male names. What's up with that?
Well, leading men in Hollywood hunks, Hugh Laurie. I don't even know who that is. Adam Levine, Johnny Depp, and Brad Pitt. Mom was in love with Johnny Depp. We know that. Dad liked Maroon 5.
He did.
Mm-hmm. And then that was just like some of the stuff, but I mean, like technology wise back then, I'm trying to remember what kind of a phone dad even had. It was not like
he had an old like Nokia flip phone.
Yeah, one of those like, yeah. So yeah. It, like, because one of the things,
Singular Wireless.
One of the things I think of though sometimes is I'm like, what would happen if he just dropped in right now, and just the change in technology since then, to be like, what is this? Pull his glasses at the end of his nose and like,
God.
So you just press it and it. Yeah, it's a touch screen.
I would get as frustrated.
He wouldn't know what to do with himself.
I would get as frustrated with him as he would get with me when I would be helping him fix stuff. When he'd be like, yo, hand me a crescent wrench. And I'm like, which one's that? He'd be like, oh my God, it's so obvious.
Put it in the auxiliary port. The what? I got a hole right here. Plug it in that. But yeah. Yeah.
That'd be wild. Yeah. And what was it? Right afterwards, like right after that year, I had a like marching band like meet or something, or what was it, we were going to San Diego to do like a competition or something, like 2 days after Christmas. So less than 5 days later, I had to go on a school trip, and Mom was supposed to be my chaperone. I think Mom ended up going home
she
early.
Went with you. Oh no.
I think she was there like one or 2 days, and then she's like, I have to like go home and handle all this nonsense.
Well, because we had to get the funeral.
And the one thing I will never forget, this is when one of my first actual interactions with my friend Mark. So he was always the like clumsy kid that always tripped over shit, and like you were just like, ah, freaking Mark. So it was like as I like Mom and I got there, I'm walking up into the band room, and this kid Mark just walks up to me and he goes, oh hey, are you the Dylan whose dad died?
And I'm just what?
Like, I'm just like, yeah, that's me. He's like, oh, I just wanted to say I'm real sorry, man.
Oh my God, what's wrong with you?
I was like, I want to punch this kid.
Who raised you?
I was like, this fucking kid right here.
Oh my God. And I'm just like,
yeah, thanks, man. And I walked into the band room and
get like, this kid away from me.
I remember I had to sit down with Mr. Whitmore and Tiffany. That was my band director, and his wife, who did the color guard stuff. And yeah, like I remember having a conversation with them and Mom in the room, because they're just like, you know, real sorry if there's anything you need, like if you don't feel like you can participate, you know, don't worry about it. And of course I was like, just I was out of it. I was just like, yeah, no, I'm totally fine. Let's do this. Woo.
Yeah.
Woo.
Yeah. I think that's like, yeah, I feel like that first year was full of a lot of distractions to not, like, I don't know about how it was for you, but I feel like I just tried to use a lot of distractions that first year to not think about it.
I think so.
If you can remember, I mean,
not really.
Yeah. I drank a lot and smoked a lot.
Yeah. Cause I don't think it was until the next year that I got my license.
Mm-hmm.
And like my permit and all that, we put that off because then Mom became afraid of driving.
Oh yeah.
And all that nonsense. So yeah, I had to wait, even though I was the oldest of all of my friends, because I was born in December, and I had to like kind of wait back a year. Or whatever the school system was, that I still ended up getting my like permit and license later than some of my other friends because of that. But yeah, no, going back to like the day that it happened, one thing that I do remember, which really, really sucked, and that was probably the hardest thing I had to do, was when I had to call Dad's best friend Bill and tell him what had happened, because Mom couldn't do it.
That you had to do
and
that.
You weren't gonna do it. And so Mom was like, sweetie, can you please call Bill? And I was like, fuck. I do not want to do this right now.
Yeah.
And so I'm like trying to get myself together. And I think I called on mom's phone.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, but he was just like, oh yeah, Denise, what's up? And I was like, oh no, Bill, sorry, it's me. And he's like, oh, what's up, Dylan? How's it going? And I was like, I have to tell you something. And he's just like, yeah, what's up? What's up, little man? I was like, it's funny because it's awkward to tell the story, just like it was awkward to tell him on the phone.
Yeah.
I was like, because it's one of those things where you just you really don't know what to say.
Mm-mm.
And yeah, I don't remember the exact words, but I was just like, so dad got in a car accident last night. And like the moment that I had said the first part, I could hear Bill kind of like, I don't know if I could hear it or if I could just like sense it.
Yeah.
But yeah, like he, right then he knew. And I was like, and he didn't make it. And then like, yeah, because Bill started crying and I started crying. That's how most of the phone calls went. But yeah, and he was just like, I feel like he had asked me some questions and like how we were doing and all of that, like trying to put on a good face for us. And then I remember him coming over with Ryan and Victoria, the kids. And yeah, like that was just,
yeah,
it was wild. And that was super difficult.
Well, it's not easy telling someone that.
Yeah, no, not at all. Oof.
No.
That's also the one story I hate telling.
Yeah. Well, understandably.
Ooh.
Well, and basically to explain what had happened or what, like I actually ordered, I don't know if I told you, I ordered and sealed up a copy of his autopsy report, but I have not opened it. I don't know if I ordered it from the county or whatever. So I don't know if it has photos and stuff. I don't necessarily want to see photos, mm-hmm. but basically what happened was he was driving down the street. And as he approached a red light, there was a car that he was coming up behind and he swerved behind that car and went through the intersection. And when he went through the intersection, another car who had a green light was going through with another gentleman who was driving home from work. And he T-boned that car and both cars just went flying in opposite directions. And they both had to have been going fast because the distance between where both of those cars landed was...
Yeah, I mean, it was that had
to
far. Be a
good like 25, 30 feet. I mean, it was, if not more, mm-hmm. maybe 40. I mean, it was a far. And he did not have his seatbelt on. And from what it sounds like, or what we may think have happened is we found out after his autopsy that he had an enlarged heart, which we didn't know. And
yeah, big heart, just like all of us.
Yeah,
we're real caring like that.
And he was a stickler for having your seatbelt buckled. It was just like a thing. Yeah. Like we always had our seatbelts on. So for him to not have had a seatbelt on, we think that he was having chest pains or something. So he took his seatbelt off. But from the impact of everything, and I think like internal bleeding and stuff, he did not make it. And the other passenger of the other vehicle also did not make it.
The other driver of the vehicle, yeah.
Or the other driver, which is also a really hard thing. And I think of that family a lot because they had a daughter who was young. And I mean, I don't know. I know... I had a friend whose parents went to church with that family. So it's a hard situation there too, because of them being in that time there at that place in time, like, not on purpose, obviously, but like, dad took someone else's life. Yeah, and that's hard. I feel really bad for that family.
Yeah, I know. I know. Over the years, you've always tried to do things without doing things. I don't know how to say it, because like, she made a really cool like cross that she painted and did it all up for our dad, and she then just did another one, for the other gentleman, and we placed it over there where the cars crashed at. And I remember multiple times you wanting to leave like a little message in a bottle.
I left a note for them once.
Oh, you did.
I found out that they got, but I'm trying to remember like what I just kind of put, just like how sorry I was, and that you know, obviously like he never would have done anything like that on purpose or anything. But and there's nothing I can say to make the situation better, but just how sorry. Why was it that happened? So yeah, I don't know anything more about that family beyond that, but I know they went to church not far from our house, in Cathedral City. But I mean, they're, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
But the other thing that I remember too, just kind of, that was kind of fucked up, was on the news, when the news covered it, he had an old Bud Light box in the back of his car that he had his tools in, just to hide them. And it was weathered, like it was like faded from the sun out there, right? So when they showed footage of, I don't remember if they showed the cars flipped, I just remember that they showed, but they showed the Bud Light box that had flown out of his car, and it was sitting in the sand, and they show this faded Bud Light thing, and they said, we don't know if alcohol played a part in this. Fuck you, KESQ News, go fuck yourselves, every last one of you. You are fucking disgusting. Like, whoever said, yeah, you can say that, whoever was like, let's get a shot of this, whoever got the shot of it, like, fuck you to the reporter, fuck you to the cameraman, fuck you to the producers, fuck you, KESQ. Go choke on a fat dick.
Because, yeah, he, so the context of that was, yeah, he would keep all his tools in that, and this in that 88 Bronco that we talked about, because we were fixing up that Bronco for me to have when I got my license.
Which is probably a good idea that you didn't, because I drove it once not long before that, and the give on the steering wheel was really bad.
Oh, that was because like,
it
was
had a lot of issues.
We hadn't replenished the power steering fluid in there. That was why it wasn't.
I was actually scared when I drove it.
But yeah, because that was like the old, that was the old family car that we had basically. Yeah. And yeah, like we'd always go 4x4 in it, and I'd always help him here and there with like, you know, fixing it up and tuning it up and like put a new radio in there. And he drove an F-150. And that was his truck. And then, yeah, I was supposed to get this Bronco, but he was going to take the Bronco over to see, yeah, his friend Tom. That was what he ended up crashing in. So yeah, so I ended up getting his truck instead, and I was like, oy. I was like, yeah, at least you get the truck. And I was like, eh.
That was a nice truck.
It was a nice truck. And you know what I felt? That was one of the other days that it really hit me hard, was the day that I had worked for a bank, and we got tickets from the bank to go see an Angels game. And that same friend, Mark, who was like, oh, are you the Dylan whose dad died? we became really good. We're really good friends.
ironically,
yeah. And he came with me to this baseball game, and we were supposed to meet you out there. And so as we're driving out to Anaheim to go see this baseball game, I end up getting rear-ended on the freeway. And when I got hit, like everybody was coming to a stop really abruptly because there was an accident ahead. Go figure, accidents make accidents.
Yeah.
I stopped as best I could. I had plenty of space. I was good. I stopped before the guy in front of me. I remember looking up in my rearview mirror and seeing another truck just coming at me. I just like that. Fuck. And then next thing I know, I'm three lanes over facing traffic. Because when the guy hit me, I spun and did a 180. And yeah, like my first thing I was like, oh shit, I have to call my sister because she'll know what to do. And then I was like, oh wait, Mark, did my phone fly out the window? And he's like, no, I don't think it did. Hold on.
All the other cars stopped in time, luckily.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And so basically where I'm going with the story from that is that even though it didn't even look that badly damaged, the truck ended up being considered totaled. And when I came home that night and I had to tell my mom that the truck was totaled, and we found out that, yeah, we were just going to have to, like, there was nothing we could do because the axle was bent and all of that. Like, I was like, this was like one of the last things that I had that was my dad's. And I like lost it that night. Mm-hmm. The night that we actually had to give it away. Cause I was like, fuck, this was his truck. Like this was,
yeah,
this is like one of the last big things that I had.
I didn't even think about that when that happened.
Yeah. That's why, like, there's a picture of it on my Instagram, I think, like the day that they were going to tow it away and take it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Cause yeah, I was like, fuck. Sorry, Dad. There goes your truck. I swear it wasn't my fault.
Yeah. Fuck, that was crazy. I remember when you called me about that, I was like, wait, what just happened? You're okay?
I was like, oh yeah, no, I'm fine. Me and Mark are good. And yeah, we still went to that Angels game. We watched that Angels game. We then went to downtown Disney and Disneyland. So I could call.
How do you get all these places? The car, the truck was still running.
Yeah, the truck. Yeah, the. So.
You drove back to Palm Springs in it.
Yeah. So
totaled, it was totaled.
Totaled is, if I remember right, the definition of it is when
the
amount of repairs would cost more than what the car's estimated value is.
That makes sense.
So yeah, like we were fine. Like the only thing I remember is that because they hit me on the passenger side,
mm-hmm.
The passenger side of the bed. Mm-hmm. So that taillight was out, mm-hmm. and that highway patrol officer was super chill. He told us, he's like, yo, if you can get some tape and you can tape the other one back up.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, as long as you have like that working brake light and then the one and like above the cab still worked. He's like, you should be fine. If you do get pulled over, here's my card. He's like, just have whoever pulls you over, wow, contact me and I'll let them know that you're good. And I was like, yo, CHP, you dope. And so, yeah. And so we drove to the game, drove to Disneyland and then drove back home. But yeah. And then at Disneyland, that was when I also got that picture of the, that couple that got married at the Cinderella style in the pumpkin.
I don't remember.
How do you not remember that? I yelled out to them because I was like, can I take a picture? And the wife, biggest smile on her face, she's like, yes. And I was like, thanks. Click. That's also on my Instagram.
She's all heading and she's like, see, I am a princess.
Yeah. I was like, that was so awesome.
Oh my God.
Yeah, no,
yeah, that wild. Is. Well, and car accidents just in general are like, I mean, before that and after that, just like a very triggering thing. Because when I got T-boned and totaled my PT Cruiser.
Hey,
that's totaling cars. I remember, because I got T-boned in an intersection by another car, and when I got, they talked me into getting in an ambulance, but. Well, when it happened, no, that's what I was going to say. When it happened, I just remember I was in the intersection waiting to make an unprotected left-hand turn. And the cars on my left that would have been coming this way or coming, you know, towards where I was at in the intersection waiting were stopped except for the farthest lane. And this other car comes piling through and I saw him coming. And then I looked and I was trying to figure out like what to do, like to get out of the way, but I knew I wasn't going to get out of the way fast enough, but it was literally the slowest moment of my life. And I remember in that moment with trying to figure out what to do, realizing that I wasn't going to get out fast enough. And then I was like, if I'm going to die right now, because the car was going pretty fast, I was like, if I'm going to die right now, it's okay. I'm going to be okay with that. Like, it was really weird. Like this surge of adrenaline, like the way your body prepares you is kind of amazing. That I was like, I was not scared in that moment. And I was like, I accepted what was going on. And if this was it, this was it. And they hit me. I ended up just needing like some like staples in the side of my head, but it wasn't like gushing or anything. But I remember after that thinking like that, you know, like thinking about him mm-hmm. as like morbid as that is in those final moments. And I hope that if that's was my experience, that if that is anything similar to what most people feel, that I would hope in that moment going through all of that, that his body prepared him and he didn't feel what was happening. Like he didn't feel pain. He knew it was bad, but he didn't feel pain. So I don't know.
That's something else that, I thought about. Cause especially since I was like, essentially I was fine. Like nothing ever came out of it. But I was somewhat hesitant about certain interactions in cars.
Yeah.
Before that, just because of being my dad died in a car accident. And then after that, I can feel my body start to tense up whenever I'm on the freeway and there are lots of cars stopping. I start to because it just freaks me out. I'm just like, oh fuck.
Yeah, it's, I don't know, a very triggering situation.
It is. One thing that we have learned coming out of all of this is that we have developed a much better relationship as siblings.
Yeah.
And it's,
I would say so.
It's one of those funny things because we've both had friends where they're just like, wow, you guys are like really close. And it's like, yeah, it's kind of because we went through some shit.
Well, I mean, it is funny because I actually just had this conversation on Friday at work mm-hmm. where I was talking to your phone gives you the just random pictures on the iPhones now. It'll just show you like memories sometimes. So one of my memories that came up was when I visited you in Florida and it's you with the crocodile and I sent you the photo holding mm-hmm. the crocodile. And so I was like, oh, and I was at work and I showed my friend at work. I said, look, that's my brother holding a crocodile. This just came up in my memories. And he's like, oh, he's like, that's your brother. I said, yeah. I was like, he's my best friend. Like
loser.
He's one of like the closest people to me. I was like, he's a really good man. Like he's a really, really good man. and like, I don't know, I'm so emotional today. I hate it. But you're my
loser. You're my
God damn it. Fuck, why are you such a good person, Dylan? I fucking hate you.
I fucking suck.
I love you so much it makes me cry.
Yeah,
but I was just talking about how much I think about you and how much you mean to me. And my coworker was like, yeah, he's like, I have a older sister, and he's like, I think she thinks a lot of me too. And I was like, you know, sometimes I wonder I'm disillusional and just think that Dylan and I are like really good friends, but it's not that way on his end.
It's a one-way street.
If I just think, I'm like, Dylan, you're my best friend, I love you so much, and he's like,
yeah,
I
know.
I was like, what if I think this and it's not true? But yeah, no, that's definitely something. And just being more protective of mom, for sure, because she's been through it. Because I couldn't imagine losing a spouse that, you know, that mom was only 45.
Yeah.
So that would mean that would mean like in 12 years, me being a widow.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy to think about.
It's wild.
Mm-hmm. And so, I don't know. And it's so funny, like, you know, here we are, how many years later? What, 13? It's been 13 years?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, yeah, because in another.
I can't count. 14, almost 14, 14. Years.
Yeah.
Almost.
Because that's one thing that it's a weird clock I've had in my head.
Mm-hmm.
Waiting for myself to turn 32, because that's going to be a really weird year for me, because that'll be half of my life that I've gone with him in it and then without him in it. And it's just a super weird thing.
It just feels like really wrong.
Yeah.
I don't know how to like explain it. It just feels super, super wrong. And it feels wrong to think about it, even though it's a reality of it. And I don't like when more time goes by, because it's like, it makes me feel more distant from him, or to just know other people in my life that are friends that I've known, that I will have known longer at some point. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like I have people that I've had friendships at this point longer than.
Oh, I already have. Yeah.
It's weird. And even just being this far down the road, I still feel like it's like, I don't know. It's like, it's a hard thing to like bring up to people, or like, you know, if people do know that they've passed and like you remember a story about them, like I sometimes don't like bringing up stories, because sometimes people that know, they're like, oh yeah.
Yeah.
And like,
it really depends on
awkward. It's awkward.
Yeah. It really depends on who you're talking to. Cause it's like some people that haven't had something like that happen, or they just haven't had like a parent or a close grandparent or something like that, or friend pass away. Basically anybody who hasn't experienced a loss, most of the time it makes it a little awkward for them, because they haven't experienced it. They don't know what's going on. So they might always assume the wound is like just always fresh. There are others that like understand. But usually I find that like as time goes on and I've met more people who have experienced loss, like you tell stories like that and they're just like, oh yeah, and it's really easy.
Well, it's interesting too, because you'll meet people in the most random situations and you find out that they've lost a parent, and you form these really, it's like, it's just this like unsaid bond with people, like the most unlikely people. And it's just kind of like where you just kind of get each other. Or I think friends that have lost parents, when I see that, like, I usually reach out and just say like, you don't have to say anything to me, but if you need to call someone even if it's in the middle of the night or something, or, you know, like, just know you have a friend that you can talk to. And mm-hmm. if you don't call me, I won't take offense to that either, but just, yeah. you know, like, just to yeah, know, just know, I mean,
if you need, yeah.
Yeah. And usually people don't call, but I mean, it's just like, I feel like I want to, if I can use, turn this into anything good, which it's like not a good situation, obviously, but if I can do anything with this, it's like, I want to be,
if I can make
a
it
support
better?
For other people. Yeah.
I guess. Yeah.
That, yeah, just to like listen or be there for other people that have unfortunately had to go through the same thing.
Yeah.
Cause it is, it's a weird alienating thing. Like, well, you were saying like things that like make you sad immediately, you know,
the fun. So whenever people tell you that it gets easier with time, I mean, sometimes they're right, but honestly, that's just a big fat lie. It never gets easier. Like for me personally, I just forget about it. But the moment that something comes up and triggers it, it's still there. Like it's never gone away. Like I said,
yeah,
I could watch Click. That shit's going to kill me at the end of that movie. He's going to be like, I'm so sorry, I didn't get to spend enough time with you guys. And, you know, blah, blah, blah. And as he's like dying on his deathbed, talking to his children, and I'm going to just be like, motherfuck, man, why?
Why? No, I mean, I think it's like it gets easier to protect yourself mm-hmm. The longer that you go, but you still will have like, I mean, I just like 2 days ago, I saw a video of this like little baby and a grandpa, and I lost it. And cried for probably like an hour.
Yeah, because then you start thinking about those things like, oh, he's never going to get to see this. He's never going to get to see that. He didn't get to see me graduate from high school. He didn't get to see me graduate from college. Yeah, things like that. I never get to introduce him to a significant other. Yeah. And yeah, all those things just start racing in your brain. And it's like, you know what? It's going to happen. Just let it happen. Just let it all out. If you can call someone to talk it over, talk it over. That's usually what ends up happening with us. Like, yeah, she'll call me and she'll just be like, oh my God, I saw this dad with his daughter and they were the most adorable thing. And I just started crying in the Target parking lot.
Every time.
And I'm just like, no, I feel that.
Yeah.
Cause yeah, sometimes that shit just happens. And yeah, you just gotta deal with it. You deal with it and you just know that, yeah, this is something that's happening. Don't try to hide it or suppress it. Just let it out.
Yeah.
Let it out and live with it.
Yeah. That's like,
cause that's one thing. That's another thing that happens when you lose someone young is certain aspects of you mature faster.
But then others don't, I feel like, or I don't know.
Oh yeah, no, then.
Well, I feel like when I get really sad, I regress to being like a child.
Cause it's like you basically regress back to when the trauma happened.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why, yeah. Like when it comes to weird, sad things, I regress back to a 16-year-old. I try and make jokes and I try and laugh it off. That's what I always do. Poop, fart jokes.
Well, I feel like it's also, I mean, they say everyone grieves in their own way, and that's 100% true too. Like, mm-hmm. it's okay to go and talk to someone, but if you don't want to talk to someone, you don't have to. Knows the answer
to that. Yeah.
Whoa. Did you hear that?
No.
Our Alexa downstairs has the Samuel L. Jackson voice, but you have to say, hey, Samuel.
What?
And it just said, no one knows the answer to that in his voice. Hey, Samuel. Can you talk to me?
I don't know how to do that one, so try asking Alexa.
I don't know what I said though to turn him, but what it just went, say? It went off.
To turn him
I don't
on.
Know you how to do Samuel? That one, but ask Alexa. Whatever I was saying, it triggered it on. Oh, that scared me.
Hold up. That's pretty great. I need to tell people that own Alexas this, that they can have Samuel L. Jackson talk to them instead. Because that's pretty bitching.
And then you just say, hey, Samuel.
Say what again?
Look, I have goosebumps. I thought it was a ghost. Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Oh, man. I don't want to be raising the dead over here. No playing jokes on me. Mm-mm.
You know, we
I miss you, but don't come scaring me.
Oh, he was really good at that. One of his favorite things to do was he would, when we would kill cockroaches or day beetles,
he would take
their dead bodies and he would put them on this barrel cactus that we had outside. And we usually had it in front of like this gate that was led to like a little atrium before our front door, or it would be right next to the front door. And he would purposefully just leave that on these barrel cactuses to freak people out when they'd come over.
We would run by. Even though we knew they were dead, we would still run by them every time.
You never know. They could come back to life. Those things are, they live through everything.
But remember, then he did this thing that was so mean. He brought a grasshopper in, one of the big ones. It was like 3 inches long, and accidentally let it go. I was in the bedroom with mom, and mom's screaming, and I'm in a corner huddled screaming bloody murder. I don't know how he ended up getting it. I was just like, that is so rude. Don't do that.
He loved doing that. That's
so
shit.
Mean.
Because hey, he grew up playing in the mud. He was just like, so dogs, mean. Whatever. Let me just grab this with my bare hand.
What's wrong with you?
Well, that was like, he used to tell us how he'd tie a string around a cicada and they just let him fly around. He's like, oh yeah, that was tons of fun.
Weird desert kid stuff.
Yeah, you make your own fun.
Well, I think I told you because I don't know, some people say they see these things if you're into like weird stuff, but like some people say that after people pass, they see signs and stuff. And so for me, I usually see them in a few different things. It's either two butterflies together. And for a long time, they were like the really like light, light, light yellow butterflies, but it was always in twos or hummingbirds. And hummingbirds especially just always seem to come around at the most random times. Like one of the times when our husky got out, and this wasn't long after Dad passed, right? And so he had dug a hole into the old folks trailer park behind us, and I could hear him.
That was the time it was you and mom that had to do it, right? And you had to pick him up from.
No, so this time he dug out under there and I could hear him barking and I couldn't get him to come over. Well, our parents had put barbed wire across the fence because people used to jump back and forth, not the old people, but just we had a bunch of rowdy kids in our neighborhood. So I couldn't jump over the fence there. I would have had to drive basically like probably like 3 miles out, like just to get around to where this was. Cause it's like all the way around. I don't know. It's hard to explain. And I could hear him and I'm standing there on a ladder by the fence with the barbed wire. And I'm like, oh God, like, where is he, please? Like, how am I don't know how I'm going to get him. Like, I don't know what to do right now. Like, God, like what do I do? What do I do? And this like little hummingbird came and it like sat on the barbed wire, like right next to me, like feet from me. And it sat and it was usually the ones with the purple on them. And it like looked up at me. And I was like, and it's weird because like in your brain, like, and you know, whatever, people can believe whatever they want. Maybe I'm imagining it, but in my mind, I like just knew at that moment, it was like a very subtle sign of like, it's going to be fine. You're going to get your dog. It's going to be okay. And it sat there for a good minute. And you know, hummingbirds don't
chill out,
let alone next to people. And it sat there for like a minute. And I was like, okay. So I got my keys and I went around and one of the neighbors had him tied up to their like a post.
Smart.
And so that was how I ended up getting him. But like little signs like that though are usually like things that I'll I've seen after. And it was a lot at first, and then it kind of filtered off. So I don't see things like this very often anymore, but I still every long once in a while will get like something, like some weird sign.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, actually we were talking about it with Will's mom and her friend, because her friend's mom just passed away. And when we were talking about it, we were talking about signs, and I was talking about hummingbirds. And this is out here in Pennsylvania. And out of nowhere, like within 20 minutes of having that conversation, a hummingbird came up, which was just kind of weird because you don't really see them out here very often. It's not a very usual thing.
Yeah, it's like I don't see hummingbirds out here.
Oh, in Florida? No way.
Yeah, no. They're not a thing.
But yeah, I don't know. This is kind of like in a few different directions. It's kind of, it's a really big, big bag to unpack.
Yeah.
There's like just so many different things to talk about with it. But I feel like I learned a few things from you that I didn't know today too.
Yeah.
Thanks. But this could be something, I mean, if people are interested or have any even specific questions that they want to ask, feel free to leave. I don't feel so weird saying it, but you know what I mean? Like if you're going through this or whatever, and you have questions, or if there's anything, like, I mean, we're at a point now, I feel like we're both pretty open books about stuff.
Yeah.
And I would love to, if I could help people talking about this kind of stuff, because it's not an easy thing to talk about. People get awkward, people get weird.
Yeah,
it's not an easy subject.
And as terrible of a thing it is as it is to say, this is something that happens every day. Like, this is a normal occurrence. The fact that it's still of like a, not necessarily a taboo, but it's just an untouched subject for the most part, is that, you know, like it's better to be more open about it and like talk about it more and to make it more accepted, because this is something that happened. Like, there are countless kids probably today that have like just found out that, oh, they've lost a parent, or like a parent's lost a child, and you know, like, it sucks. And it's like, I know one thing that always helped mom was the fact that mom always like would find like those support groups online and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And like, she was able to talk and communicate with other people that had similar experiences, because it's,
well, probably just things she couldn't talk to us about too, because
able to, it's nice to be able to form a bond with someone that has gone through something similar.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're able to understand more what you're going through, what you've been through, and what you're currently going through, which is always nice, which is also why I need to try and see if I can, which, like I said, if you enjoyed this, I would say watch The Honeydew with Ryan Sickler.
Yeah.
We'll try and post a link to his channel underneath. Mm-hmm. Cause that was one thing that really got me was, that first video of his that I watched was him talking about his story, because he also lost his dad at 16.
I didn't realize it was at the same time that you did.
Same age. Except that he didn't have his mom there. So it was him, his twin brother, and his younger brother. And what happened was they just found their dad. Like, their dad passed in his sleep, I think, if I remember right.
Oh.
And so, like, it's only these boys in this house. So, like, they found their dad, and they had to call the police and all of that. And it's like, because it's one of those things. And that's the way that he talked about it was something that made me feel really good, weirdly enough.
Yeah.
Because he was able to talk about it. He was able to share his experience. And then, he had more stuff that happened that, like I said, go listen to it. Cause you're like, damn, this poor fucking guy.
Send me that link again. Cause I will listen to that today.
Yeah. I'll have to find.
I know I listened to part of something.
So the other one I sent you was a comedian, Taylor Tomlinson, because she lost her mom to cancer when she was like 8 or something like that. And that was one that I was like, this is just really good, because they both talk about their experiences of losing a parent at a young age and what that's done to them mm-hmm. and how that's helped shape them. And yeah, I sent that to you because I was like, yo, this, some of the things that she talked about and some of her thought, like some of the way her thought processes have evolved as she's gotten older, they, what she talked about, they reminded me of some of the ways that I think and the way that my yeah. brain has evolved through the accident. And I was like, yeah, I was like, this is some shit.
Oh, but don't yeah. worry.
They also got really good fun stories too. Like,
oh no, I'm sure, you know, you gotta mix it up. Can't be all sad.
Yeah. He talks about some lady that, it was cause he does one called the Honeydew with Y'all, where if you're part of his Patreon, he gets the people that send him money every month and mm-hmm. he like asks them to come on the show. Mm-hmm. And it's great because they make the fucking best clips. he had a clip. I sent it to a couple guys. I'll try and send it to you where he's talking to this lady. He's like, whoa, 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 hold on. You're telling me this guy paid you $5,000 to, what was it, to like to tie him up or beat him up or something like that? And like, that was it. And she's just like, yeah, yeah, no, like $5,000. It was easy. He's like, that's all you had to do. She's like, well, no, I mean, like I peed in his mouth some and stuff, but like it's his laugh too, because he's just like, I can't mimic it. It's so good.
How did we get to this subject?
You're highlighting the lowlights, because then the next clip he's like, whoa, 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 you tell me, how many times did you get shot? She's like, oh, I've been shot countless times. I've been like tons of shootings. And she's like, yeah, one time I got shot 3 times in the leg. And he's like, whoa, 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 you tell me one time you got shot 3 times.
Oh, highlights and the lowlights.
You gotta highlight the lowlights. Yeah, it's good because like I said, the one reason why I really enjoy that is because, yeah, it shows that everybody goes through shit. And mm-hmm. I guess that's one thing that I've really taken away from our dad passing, is that I always try to not make the snap judgments, because I know that, like, yeah, like, I don't fucking know. This person could just be having a really freaking shitty day because, yeah, who knows? Maybe they lost someone. Maybe they lost an animal. Like,
oh, wow. You got so wise from this. I'm like, why is that person a fucking asshole? I got angrier from this situation.
No, don't get me wrong. I definitely get angry. I definitely get angry, but I don't just let it out right away.
Yeah.
I definitely like just let it sit there. But I do. I try and sit back and I try and be like, well, yeah, like, what could have happened that made them act this way?
Yeah.
Cause that's why, like, it's even funny when I argue now, it's one of the arguments I had was, it wasn't even really an argument, but like, it was when I was back in school, these two guys got in a fight. The teacher came over and he's like, all right, hold on. I'm gonna get your side of the story. And then I'm gonna get your side of the story. So he's talking to the first guy, and then the other guy is sitting at my table and he's just like, no, that's not how it happened. And I was like, all right, dude, like, one, it's one thing when you guys are like arguing in the middle of the class and disrupting it, but it's a whole nother thing to like not let this guy tell his side of the story when yeah. you're obviously going to get your chance. And I was like, dude, shut the fuck up. Everyone in the class shuts up and they're staring. And I'm like, he's like, no, man. Like, that's not how it happened. I'm like, you're acting fucking childish right now. I was like, shut the fuck up and wait your goddamn turn. And he's just like, no. I was like, I'm sorry. Are you fucking talking back to me? That's even more childish. I was like, I ripped into him. I was like, I thought you were in the military. They didn't teach you fucking better. I was like, shut up, sit down and wait your fucking turn. Then he shut up and everyone's like, okay, back to work, Dylan. Dylan's done with his rant. And I was like, fuck you guys, I need a coffee.
Well, that's the thing. If you don't know Dylan, it takes a lot to push you to like a breaking point. But when you get mad, it is red.
It's bad.
You don't want to make nice people mad. It is red.
Incredible Hulk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think this has been a good constructive moment for us. Look at us.
Yeah.
I mean, I would be open to doing another episode like this just because there's so many different avenues of this topic. And but that also is, of course, if it's something that you feel okay with talking about. I feel like this was like a good,
yeah,
I feel like this was therapeutic today, kind of. I learned some things about you I didn't know.
I've been waiting to do this because, like I said,
I wasn't sure if I wasn't sure if you wanted to talk about it, so that's why when I asked you, I was like,
I'm always open.
If you're open to this, but I don't want you to feel pressured to do something you don't want to do. And it's not an easy subject to talk about.
Yeah. Well, that's like, I always, when people ask, like, I never mind. I like telling them and letting them know just everything. I think I told you back in the day, one of my friends, she misunderstood the definition of bastard. And she's just like, oh, well, you're the nicest bastard I've ever met. I was like, close, but not quite. Not God,
man, you get just shit on for having a dead dad. Everyone just shits on you. Your dad's dead, you bastard. That sucks. That you're so nice. God.
Yeah, you just take it in stride. You just smile and you go, oh, fuck you too.
I always say I never had daddy issues until I lost mine, and now I have daddy issues. Life was fine. I was well adjusted, but then my dad died and now I have daddy issues. Sucks for me. I made it so far.
That's a t-shirt right there. I never had daddy issues till I lost mine.
Yeah. And now I'm fucked. I am fucked. No, I mean, I would say like something like, at least, like, you know, our dad wasn't perfect by any means, but like, we were really lucky to have someone that was like very involved and also like as a male figure who never spared, like was never like shy or whatever about saying like, I love you.
Yeah.
Or like he like was a very hands-on, very touchy feely, like very like not in a weird way, like, but he was like a very physical person.
Yeah, he never shied away from giving a hug or
no,
just being there for people.
Yeah, and I mean, like, I feel like in that way, like, just to have been so lucky, and I think, like, for me at least, like, it instilled in me, like, knowing in terms of like men that I surround myself with or men that I'm close to, like, or what I look for in a partner is like, I know what I like, you know, what I am worth and what I don't, you know, that I don't have to settle for, you know, and I'm very lucky in that. You're lucky. But, you know, like just the confidence of having a good father figure that I feel just like very lucky that even though it was cut short, like, holy shit, we got really, really lucky to have, yeah, to have a good relationship with our dad for as long as we did. But yeah, I feel like this is a good place to wrap up. And if anyone has any questions or whatever, feel free to ask. You can also, man, I feel like such a dick. Then, and you can email us at relatablerodartypodcast@gmail.com. That's relatablerodartypodcast@gmail.com.
God, you gotta fucking cut that. That's so long. Nobody wants to type that shit out. But yeah, oh my God.
Our podcast. Ask us
about our experiences, just fucking let us know.
Oh my God. So, like, how did it feel when your dad died?
Oh my God. Was it crazy? It was
crazy. Girl, sit down and pour some tea. Let me tell you.
Fuck yes. You just reminded me that I bought some digestives at the store. I'm gonna have me some fucking chai. Ooh, some chai and digestives sound good right now.
You better get, well, you work from home, so I guess it doesn't matter. I was gonna say, you know, you should have those 24 hours before going back to work, right? Otherwise you might end up pooping your brains out when you should be working.
No. I think they just call them digestives. They're like the little British cookies.
Oh, I thought you meant you got smooth move tea.
No, fuck no. No,
I thought you got yourself laxative tea.
No, I'm gonna have a chai. I'm gonna have a chai masala, and then just have these. Yeah, they're like little they're British biscuits that just go really good with tea and coffee. And yeah, I'm gonna have that right now. That sounds freaking great.
Yeah.
Booyah.
Well, join us when we come back. Ask us some questions. We'll give you some answers. And
did your dad die? Do you want to talk about it? Let us know. Did your mom die? We don't really get that, but we can try.
Done. Oh my God. We are open to all deaths. Just no new ones. Just no new, all deaths. No new ones in our family is all I'm asking.
Please, please, no. No more.
Yeah, no more. We can't do that.
Everybody's dying, bitch. That's one of my favorite things from It's Always Sunny. And Charlie's like, oh no, I'm not gonna die. Max, everybody's dying, bitch. Shut up.
Oh my God. All right. Well, hopefully this was helpful, and we'll pick up on this on the next episode. So hope you enjoyed episode 19.
That's right. Hope you enjoyed. And I don't know what day you're going to put this out, but if you put it out on the 25th, happy birthday, Papa. You happy old birthday. Fart.
Ew. God. Him being in that coffin, like if he farted, he probably like hotboxed himself full of farts. Ooh, 14 years of farts.
Did we tell the apple juice story?
Okay, you can finish it off with that. I gotta pee so bad though.
So the apple juice story.
Okay, we'll finish this off with something light. Ready? Go.
It was something light, all right. I'm lightheaded from all those freaking fumes.
Well, he felt light afterwards.
So we were all the two of us and then our dad were at home. No idea what the heck happened that day, but for some reason, something possessed this man to not only buy a thing of apple juice, but to drink the whole freaking thing in one day. So we're sitting there at like our kitchen counter. I don't even know what we were doing, but our dad's sitting there and he's talking to us. And then all of a sudden you just hear this and his face lights. I think that's where I get that from. Now that I think about it, his face lights up and he's just like, uh-oh.
We're all sitting on the couch too. We're like,
yeah, we're like, wait,
what's going on what? Over there? And usually he would be like, oh, that was a mouse on a motorcycle, but he didn't have one joke to make, and so we knew something was brewing.
You hear that duck quack?
No, yeah, no he jokes. Just, he looked like, uh-oh.
Like he stood up straight, like just shocked. You could tell his cheeks were clenched. He waddled to turn himself around, and then he did like a weird waddle fast walk, which that's also where I get that from. Now that I think about it. To the bathroom. And so in our house, to get to the bathroom from the living room, you went into the hallway, and then the hallway led all the way to the bathroom. And the whole way from that first waddle step, he was farting. Just,
well, it was every step was like the whole way. And then
so bad. And you could hear him just like,
yeah, he was like crying in the bathroom. He's like, oh no,
This is the longest string of farts we've ever heard in our life. And we're like, ew, it smells. And we're like, okay, let's have a contest. Let's see who can last in the hallway the longest because it smells so freaking bad.
Yeah. And he was like, that's not funny. You guys are so mean. He's like, get away. And we were like, poor man's crying just having up.
Massive diarrhea.
And we're just like, we can't breathe in here. Can you imagine you just crapping your brains out and your kids are outside of the bathroom having a contest of who can stand in the hallway longest, just laughing at you and just like fucking with you.
You're just like, I fucking hate them.
That is literal hell. Oh my God.
There you go. That's how we'll end it. Don't drink a whole thing of orange or apple juice. Yeah,
that's really the takeaway from today.
That gives you the farts.
Mm-hmm. It does. All right. Well, thanks for watching. Till next time.
Love you.
Love you. Bye.
Bye.